Now I will do something to really annoy you. That's why, although I of course totally support black liberation in the precise sense of, as a Hegelian, I support it. For example, you know, Black Lives Matter. I totally, precisely as a Hegelian universalist, I totally reject the stupid white liberal counterpoint made, among others, by Trump himself. No, why only black lives matter? All lives should matter. No, it's a lie. Because that's, we are dealing here with what Hegel calls concrete universality. In every concrete historical situation, a certain type of racism, state violence, is the concrete type which stands for universality. Today you have a lot of violence in the United States, but you cannot say, let's just look at all of it. What happens by the state apparatus police to black people is the emblematic figure. You know, it's the same paradox, maybe I exaggerate a little bit, as if to research racism in Germany in 1930s and ignore anti-Semitism. No, if you talked about race, then you had to mention, that's why. But nonetheless, now I come to my final point, maybe problematic to you, but it's crucial. My reference here will be, and I say this to provoke you, I think these lines are more actual than ever. The black activist that I really appreciate is those who are aware of the traps of identity politics. White liberals love identity politics because if you look closely at how it functions, it reduces the other, underprivileged, to a particular identity. White liberals love Native Americans who dance their folkloric dances, who have some shitty deep insight into how we shouldn't objectivize nature. You know, before you mine a mountain, you should ask the spirit of the mountain and do it if you are allowed, all that stuff. They love it. What they don't like is if those underprivileged don't just play the game, we want to assert our particular identity, but no, sorry guys, what we are oppressed in a much more radical way. We want to oppose you at the level of a different universality. The only true struggle is the struggle for universality itself. And I would go to the end here. And now I slowly am coming to an end. Just one quote, surprising for you, and then one wonderful Jewish joke. With this I will finish. First the quote, it will maybe surprise you. Who is it from? It should be remembered today. Huey Newton, the founder and theorist of the Black Panther Party. He so clearly saw, half a century ago, the limitation of local national resistance to the global reign of capital. He even made a key step further and rejected the term decolonization as inappropriate. His point was that one cannot fight global capitalism from the position of national unities. Here is his statement from a unique dialogue. This was a beautiful, sublime moment. In 1972, Huey Newton had a dialogue with Erik Erikson, the Freudian psychoanalyst, who was deeply sympathetic, white guy, old white guy from Europe, but deeply sympathetic to the Black Panthers. And here is what Huey Newton said. I admire this. Quote, "We in the Black Panther Party saw that the United States was no longer a nation. It was something else. It was more than a nation. It had not only expanded its territorial boundaries, but it had expanded all of its control as well. We called it an empire. Now, at one time, the world had an empire in which the conditions of rule were different, the Roman Empire. The difference between the Roman and the American empires is that other nations were able to exist external to and independent of the Roman Empire because their means of exploitation, conquest and control was all relatively limited. But what we, when we say empire today, we mean precisely what we say. An empire is a nation state that has transformed itself into a power controlling all the world's lands and people. We believe that there are no more colonies or neo-colonies. If a people is colonized, it must be possible for them to decolonize and become what they formerly were. But what happens when the raw materials are extracted and labor is exploited within a territory dispersed over the entire globe? When the riches of the whole earth are depleted and used to feed a gigantic industrial machine? Then the people and the economy are so integrated into the imperialist empire that it's impossible to decolonize, to return to the former conditions of existence. If colonies cannot decolonize and return to their original existence as nations, then nations no longer exist, nor, we believe, will they ever exist again, and so on and so on. That's where we are today. The problem of identity politics, where I have a problem with it, is that it presupposes that, how to put it, that identities exist. I don't think they exist. And that's my problem even with, for example, certain versions of LGBT, to make a jump. I'm approaching the end. So oh. Yeah, of LGBT plus. My perception is again and again that they still accept the fact that we have gender identities, they just want to expand the list. It's not just the traditional binary masculine-feminine, it's and then you get 30, 40 books, bisexual, multisexual, asexual, whatever you want. But the way, to repeat my old joke, maybe some of you know it, the way I would approach LGBT is, as a Hegelian, my favorite moment of it is the plus, LGBT plus. What is this plus? There is the wrong British empiricist reading of it. That plus simply means maybe there are some identities that we didn't yet discover, so we should keep a mind open. What if tomorrow a guy comes who said, I am a trigender butch or whatever, oh sorry guy, you were not in the list, we will add you to the list. But if there is a lesson, is that today subjectivity is this plus itself, non-identical. This idea that you can be plus in the sense of excess over identity. And this is today's subjectivity, the plus itself. The psychoanalytic name for it is hysteria, feminine hysteria, which we should not read it in a male chauvinist way as hysterical women. For Jacques Lacan, this is the highest mode of subjectivity. Lacan emphasizes that all creative science, not university science, where you just report on the results, but creative science is hysterical. Hysterical in the sense of what? What is hysteria at its most fundamental? It's precisely questioning your identity, even at the most primitive level. I'm sorry to be so vulgar, but if you are heterosexual and love a woman, and the woman asks you this eternal stupid question, it can be annoying. Tell me, why do you love me? Of course, there is no answer to this one. The moment you answer it, you are not truly in love. But you know, what is, this is the basic hysterical question. You, the discourse of the master society, you are telling me what I am, a wife, a servant, whatever. Why am I what you are saying that I am? This basic doubt of your identity, which precisely opens up a universal dimension.